your screen. We can see it, which is perfect. Thank you.
Perfect. Hi, so I'm Ellie. We're part of N.E.S.T, which is Northeast Solidarity and Teaching. I'm Ellie and I am the school's project worker. So I originally started volunteering for N.E.S.T in the second year of my English Literature with Creative Writing degree, which was about 4 years ago now. And I just kept volunteering. When I graduated, I volunteered remotely. And just in the past month, I got employed as the school's project worker, which I'll tell you a little bit more about later.
Hi everyone, I'm Bridget. So I started N.E.S.T in 2016 with a group of my friends and then ran it as a volunteer for 3 years while I completed my studies at Newcastle University. So I did a psychology undergrad and then a master's in clinical psychology. And then we found the funding to run N.E.S.T full time in 2019. So as I graduated from my master's, I moved into running N.E.S.T full time. And I've been doing that, since then.
So we're just going to show you a short video, which is just about N.E.S.T in general and the sessions that we run.
I'm not sure if it's playing, Ellie. The video isn't playing on our side. What we can see now is the presentation slides.
Right.
You might have to just stop sharing the screen and then share it again with the video.
Yeah, we'll try that.
Yeah, no worries.
Go back to stop sharing and then you can share the sound.
Yeah, we could see that video. It's perfect. I think it's just the sound wasn't on. There might be an option when you share your screen to share sound as well in one of the settings.
Is that better?
Yes, perfect. We can see and hear the video now.
So that was a video which we made a couple of years ago, and it was filmed at one of our community sessions. So we'll go into a little bit of detail about all of the sessions that we run and the services that we provide But first of all, I just wanted to show, tell you a little bit about how N.E.S.T. was set up and how we came to kind of do what we do. So first of all, just to explain this picture. So this was when I was in the third year of my undergraduate degree doing psychology, and I had a stats assignment. And this was one of our early community sessions where we didn't really have any children. So we just had this one mother who was 16 who'd come over from Sudan and wanted to learn English with us. So it was usually me babysitting this little girl, Fatima, whilst trying to kind of coordinate the sessions and also keep up a little bit with uni work. So Fatima's now five. And the kind of before and after picture is terrifying, but it's really good to look back and kind of see where we came from. So as Miriam said, we started in 2016, and one of the first Syrian families who were dispersed to Gateshead had requested some support from the council. And the council reached out to the students' union, who then kind of put out a notice. Me and my friends saw it and wanted to go to help this the family. So we went to Gateshead, which is just across the river from us, and did kind of homework support and English language support with the parents for about 6 weeks. And then during those 6 weeks, the family had kind of reached out to other people that they knew and said, oh, this is going on, would you like to come along? And I'd kind of told my friends about it, and they were interested in coming. So we decided to move the project from the community centre that we're working in, Gateshead, to the university campus, where we could have kind of the rooms for free, and there was, you know, nice facilities and security and all of that. And as we did that, we were able to kind of advertise the project. So we started building like a bit of a brand. We put information out to local colleges, to the council, and we started recruiting students from societies. We went to lectures and did kind of shout outs, and kind of quite quickly began to gather a lot of momentum. So by the first year, we had opened three sessions a week, and we had about 100 student volunteers and about 150 learners coming. So we focused mainly on teaching English, but we also had a conversation group. We'd set that up because one of the learners had come to us and said, like, I don't know how to ask for things at the shop. I don't know how to call my children's school and say that he's ill today. So we set up like a conversation group where people could practice in these kind of role play situations. After the first year, we found a little bit of funding. We were able to open some sports sessions, some children's sessions, and we started doing some trips. And the project just continued to gather momentum. So by the third year, we had enough funding to have myself run the project full time. And from there, we were able to kind of build more structure and stability. And now we have, as you've said, around 300 to 500 student volunteers taking part annually. And we support hundreds of refugees and asylum seekers in Newcastle, nationally and internationally. Now during lockdown, we were able to move everything online, and that allowed us to kind of continue to support people who were dispersed away from Newcastle, and to support people's families who kind of remained in other countries before family reunification. So we'll go on to tell you a little bit more about kind of how N.E.S.T. runs now and how we've gone through COVID. First, we just wanted to give you a little bit of an opportunity to hear from some learners. So we've got a video which is some kind of interviews with children and adults at N.E.S.T. And kind of to see a little bit about what they think and hear from them. Stop sharing first. Get our technology sorted out.
Try again.
I came here, my English was really quite, it's not that much I can't speak. And then I met a lot of friends, students doing volunteering, and then my English started to improve. I think N.E.S.T. is the best for me.
Hi, I've been attending here for about 2 years, so we like it. This kind of to improve your English, to find your way. Also, a lot of activities, basketball, football sessions, so many things, even art. It's a really good place. I love it.
I hear Bridget one time, like she's saying she want to get N.E.S.T. bigger, and that's what I hope to, and that's what everybody hopes. Thank you for everything.
I hope the N.E.S.T. to improve and go forward, and I appreciate all the hard works. I hope to keep coming to the N.E.S.T. to get the opportunity to a better life and future career.
Bye. Ahmad. Ciao.
This or this, yeah?
So this guy, this guy is a big friendly giant.
Big, huh?
He's a giant.
Big fat giant.
It's a big friendly giant,
very
not fat. Big
it's
fat
a
giant.
Big fat giant.
Big friendly giant.
Very fat.
So yeah, we filmed that just before lockdown, and it was the learners had been kind of given an opportunity to write something to practice like their English skills, and one of the learners had suggested, oh, let's write something about N.E.S.T., like for N.E.S.T., so we ended up making a video of it, and it turned out really cute, so we often play that one. So now I'll tell you a little bit about what support we provide for adults, and then I'll pass over to Ellie and she'll talk about what we do for children as well. So the project started with English support for adults, and as we kind of continue to expand, we realised that was a huge need in Newcastle. So we do have two colleges, Newcastle and Gateshead College, but both of them at the minute have over a 6 month waiting list for new ESOL learners. So when people come into the country, they're going to have to wait between 6 months and a year to start learning English at college. There are also other charities that provide English support, but these tend to be also during the day. So if people are trying to work or they have children that they need to look after, it's very difficult to get to these classes. So N.E.S.T. provides support in the evening at the weekend, and with child care support as well. And we hope that this kind of like fills a gap without kind of replicating services or competing with funding. And we're able to provide one-to-one and group teaching for adults every day of the week. And people can come by themselves with their families or, you know, with children as well. So we have classes online and in person. The online classes run later on, so they're 7:30 till 8:30, and then the face-to-face classes are a little bit earlier, so if people wanted, they could attend both classes. And we have learners come in to our classes online from Newcastle, but also up and down the country, and some learners joining from other countries if they've been kind of moved back from, you know, pushed back from England, or they've ended up somewhere else. So we've got quite a big community joining us online. During COVID, so before COVID, we didn't have anything online, but as we went into lockdown, we weren't able to run any face-to-face classes, so we moved the whole programme online. And now coming back onto campus this year, we've tried to maintain a hybrid programme so that we can kind of continue to support learners who aren't here anymore, but it also reduces the kind of a financial, geographical barrier to accessing ESOL, as people don't have to pay for transport into the city centre. And we've teamed up with other charities on digital inclusion schemes to provide tablets and data packages so that people can access our classes who don't have a mobile phone with Wi-Fi. So we run in-person classes on campus. So learners come into the university, they're able to kind of store their books and equipment here, and we welcome them into the building. They're able to get some kind of refreshments, and then they come to our classes. They're registered by student volunteers, and then we have student volunteers teaching the classes, and some volunteers work in one-to-one as like classroom assistants to support the learners whilst they're at our lessons. So some of the students might have teaching qualifications or experience teaching, and others will just be brand new to it. So we aim to provide some training to boost confidence, but we also make sure that learners know kind of this isn't a formal ESOL certificate, it's just there to support you. So it's quite an informal, relaxed environment, and I think it provides a different space for learners. So often people tell us that when they're in college, they feel nervous to ask questions, or they're in such a big group that the level of English is quite varied. So we try to allow people to feel comfortable to ask questions and to come with their college homework and just get that one-to-one support that they need. Uniquely, I think in Newcastle, we offer one-to-one tuition for adults for free. So that's our probably our most popular class. And we do that online and in person. And then we also have classes where we help people apply to university. So Newcastle University is a university sanctuary with 3 sanctuary scholarships. And a lot of our learners want to apply for those. So we do some support classes to help them. And obviously there's a lot of people who are unsuccessful. So we also work with those people who are unsuccessful to look at what they might be able to do to improve the chance at the applying to university next time, and how they can think of other options like apprenticeships or that kind of thing. So now we're going to move on to talking about the children. But before we do, we've got a video of a youth residential that we took them on this summer.
So it was to take 15 teenagers to Newbrough, and so it was sort of outward bound activities and confidence and leadership building activities. So it was really good, really good fun. I didn't go on it, but Bridget did. But we have a video of it as well.
Hi, I am Yusuf Badram. Hi, miss, how are you? I like in the trip when I play the piano, and I like when we play together football.
Hello, I'm Ali, and I think the camping really helped me to make friends, to discover new things, and to be productive. I really enjoy the camping.
So, what's your name?
Benjamin.
Where are you from?
El Salvador.
And how would you rate this trip out of 10? 1 to 10. 10 being excellent, 1 being not so good.
For me, it's excellent, this idea, because it's funny and you can meet more people.
What have you enjoyed the most about this trip?
Everything.
Everything?
Yeah.
Even the food?
Yeah.
Are you sure? Was my cooking really that good?
I love how I played football in the trip. I went to the park. I learned how to make fire. I met new people. I loved how I made food. I loved how we did the quiz night. I loved everything in the trip. Thanks, N.E.S.T. يكتب بالمكتوب ونكون حداك آه يا قلبي شوف هواك وين رماني ف
فوق بحر صافي بمواج وداني معاه تبع رياح الحب وعندك حطني ودعني وصاني وقال لي حبيبك ما تنساه.
Hello, my name is Usama. I was so happy to be in the N.E.S.T. trip, and the leaders were so kind, and I like getting lost. I did like getting lost in the jungle, and everything was so nice. Yeah, and I like everything there. And thank you for, and thanks for everyone.
So basically they're saying, I am this guy?
No, you're this guy.
Oh, wow.
No, you have hair in your mouth.
Yeah.
And then you know.
Oh, so I'm not this one anymore.
No, you're this.
قالوا لي خرجتي في الظلام وعليا سولتي في غياب القمر بعيونك ضويتي قالوا لي عليك نجمام يا نجمام يا بنتي وين كنتي هذا شحال قولي لي علاش هربتي قالوا لي خرجتي في الظلام وعليا سولتي في غياب القمر.
Hi miss, how are you? I like when we go to the trip, when we play like a team in the jungle, and when we play football, it's so exciting.
Powerful.
And I want to say thank you for the 9 leaders who are supporting us.
I love N.E.S.T. and thank you.
So Ahmed, who was dancing at the end there, at the start of the trip, he didn't want to come with us because he was really nervous. He's actually a family reunification case. So his mum had come across a couple of years and he was left, he was stuck in Libya. So he'd only just been in Newcastle for about 3 months. But his mum was really wanting him to come because she wanted to make sure that he had kind of that experience. And by the end of the trip, he was, as you can see, fully confident and into it. So we love that video as well.
So I'll tell you a little bit more about what we do for the children. So at the start of lockdown, we were kind of wondering what we could do with the children to really engage them online, because that can be quite challenging, especially when you've got younger children. So we set up a circus youth club where they learned sort of circus skills, and they worked in teams in breakout rooms, and they got to sort of learn new things in a fun way. And so it's been, we've continued to do it throughout the whole of lockdown, and we still continue it now. So we run one session in person now, as well as one online. And it's been really great for family reunification cases where part of the family is maybe in a completely different country and some are still here, and they can work together in this sort of really fun but quite different way, rather than just a regular Zoom call. They're getting to learn sort of circus skills together in a really sort of interesting way. We also, during the weekends, and in fact every day, we offer childcare support alongside our adult sessions, because it can be a real barrier for people, because childcare can be expensive, and not a lot of places that do English classes will also offer childcare. And while the adults are receiving English lessons, we'll help with homework, sort of one-to-one working with a volunteer, just to give them that extra support that they may not be getting in school, because teachers simply don't have time. And especially when they get to sort of GCSE age, doing GCSEs in another language can be really, really challenging for them. So to just give them that extra bit of help, especially with students who are sort of learning more advanced things and can explain them really well because they know them really well. We also have mother and baby groups, where we offer, again, English support to the mothers, and we have volunteers who will look after the babies, which are really fun and really cute as well. One of my favourites. And we do youth trips and residentials, as you saw in the last one. We do youth trips to sort of historical places and fun places like the beach or trampoline parks. And we're planning on doing a residential next year in the summer as well as a sailing trip as well, for a week, which will be really exciting. And we're setting up the schools program at the moment, which is what my role is. And this is where we're going into 5 schools to begin with, 5 days a week, and with the hope of sort of expanding into more schools as we set up. And this will be mainly playground supports, doing fun sessions in the playground to improve sort of aid integration within the school children, and then reading support with some of the children who are refugees and asylum seekers, as well as some local children who can, again, help with integration, but also be sort of model English language speakers. So they can help the refugee and asylum seeking children with their English. It's worked really well so far. We're currently in 2 schools and we're going to the next 3 within a couple of weeks. So this is another video of another one of our trips out into the community.
the bit at the end with Muhammad and that sewing needle always gets me. That has absolutely no control over.
So integration is obviously something that's really important to us at NEST, as well as to sort of the refugee and asylum seeking community. We want to make sure that our learners are getting as much support as possible with integrating. And so we do this in a variety of ways. So we've always run sort of sports sessions. It's a really good way to get the learners sort of speaking English in a slightly different environment from a classroom, because often that can be quite difficult. And this is more conversational English with the volunteers. It's also really good fun and everyone gets really involved and absolutely loves it. So we're currently doing that in collaboration with Newcastle United Football Club Foundation. So they support us with that, which is a really amazing thing for the learners, as it's something that they will recognise for a lot of the time. We also do trips, as you've seen in a couple of the videos, into local facilities, such as sort of teaching people how to use the metro, teaching them to taking them to the library to get library cards, taking them to Granger Market to show them where they can get cheaper food, really practical things that can sort of help them live just a bit of an easier life in Newcastle. But we also do fun trips, so to the beach, to national parks, where everyone can sort of just let loose a little and have a little bit of fun in ways that they might not be able to. A lot of these places are quite far away from the city, and so we're able to provide that sort of transport and food that they may not be able to do otherwise. We also love to do sort of art sessions, cooking, drama sessions, throughout the year for both adults and children. It's really important that we sort of encourage people to do these different things outside of the classroom just to get a lot more rounded experience. And we also do referrals into music services, especially for the younger children who maybe won't be able to access that from a financial point of view.
Okay, so we're going to talk a little bit about the kind of additional support that we provide away from the actual sessions. So we have a community distribution scheme where we try to provide sort of support facilitating learners to access our services. So a lot of the learners who we support are in kind of quite extreme poverty. Poverty in Newcastle is quite widespread anyway, but as people kind of come into the city, there's a real lack of food, clothing, and then when they become have refugee status and move into like council properties, things like fuel, electricity also become really difficult. So this picture shows some of the care packs, which are food parcels that we made over the summer holidays to go out to families with children who were on free school meals who couldn't access those vouchers. We also do kind of care packs for people as they come and arrive in the contingency initial accommodation in Newcastle. So you'll probably know the kind of MIAs and Home Office using hotels to house refugees and asylum seekers, or asylum seekers who come into the country. The North East has 6 initial accommodation centres. One in Newcastle and one in Gateshead to have families in. So we provide clothing packs, toiletries, toys, things like nappies, prams, anything that families really need as they're kind of coming into Newcastle with nothing. We also do things like Christmas drives. We provide toys and kind of things that children might need around the holiday periods and at Eid as well. So this is kind of picture shows some of the emergency packs that we made for people from Afghanistan coming into the city over the summer. We also work with children who are in social services support. So we have a few families who were kind of together and with their parents, and then during the time that we've been supporting them have become separated. So in that case, we can support both the adults and the children. Some of what we do is kind of just, you know, nice things that improve the comfort of the children. So getting them like a suitcase that they can take their clothes in rather than using bin bags, or providing kind of family sessions where instead of having family contact in kind of quite a clinical room in one of the community centres, we can run a trip where social workers and foster carers can come. So it's a safe environment, but the families can have a good day out. So it's kind of a little bit separate to the main sessions, and it's a little bit more behind the scenes. So volunteers can't just kind of drop into this support, but volunteers who have the skills, so they might be studying to be a social worker, or they might work in psychology or medical, students can have a little bit more of a unique experience volunteering, but really make kind of impactful work. So this is a picture from one of the awards nights. N.E.S.T. has won various awards, but kind of behind that is the student impact that it's having. So we've got a little slide here just about the impact that it has on students, because I think it's quite difficult to describe how much of an impact it does make. A lot of students who are volunteering or who have volunteered previously might have only been involved in things like fundraising or kind of quite, you know, they wouldn't have had the hands-on experience that they get at N.E.S.T. So a lot of the time when students first come into N.E.S.T., they might be a little bit nervous, not sure that they have the skills to be able to support. But we were able to provide training at the start and end of each of our sessions, so the students can volunteer quite quickly. And as they get involved in the project, we've really seen people's confidence build. They become more employable. A lot of students who have volunteered at N.E.S.T. have gone into work relating to refugees or relating to teaching. So we have alumni from N.E.S.T. who are now kind of working for the UNHCR, working for UNICEF, doing humanitarian aid work. And they credit some of that to their experiences with N.E.S.T. and the confidence they built here with us. So as well as that, we hope that we're building kind of a community in Newcastle who are educated about the difficulties that people are facing. And the students who go on to live in Newcastle will help to kind of increase the amount of local community who are aware. And those who go on to move elsewhere can help kind of spread that awareness wherever they go afterwards. So as well as being obviously hopefully hugely beneficial to the refugee community, this project is almost mutually beneficial to student volunteers. Students at N.E.S.T. do everything, the teaching, the behind the scenes, social media, all the videography that you've seen. So there's something for all students, whether they're confident speaking English or there might be international students who can help us translate. Media students, teachers, everybody can come to N.E.S.T. and feel kind of that they've done something worthwhile. And that we work together. So this is a picture of one of our community sessions. And Newcastle University is very kind of a white university, but N.E.S.T. is one of the most diverse communities on campus, other than kind of the kind of country specific, like Pakistan society. N.E.S.T. probably is the most diverse, so it's a really nice place to be, and hopefully welcoming to all students, which is really important as well. So that's pretty much all we had to discuss today, but we're happy to take any kind of questions or any thoughts that you might have.